Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن
نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم اللهم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي اللهم ربنا آتنا من لدنك رحمة وهيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا اللهم ربي يسر ولا تعسر وتمم بالخير بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم صدق الله صدق الله العلي العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين أما بعد الحمد لله all praises and thanks due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for blessing us to be here today to perform the Salat al-Jum'ah, the Friday congregational prayer and to listen to the khutbah or the sermon, inshallah. Alhamdulillah, all praises and thanks are due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for choosing us to belong to the followers of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I pray and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower his peace and blessings onto the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in and upon his family members and his companions, inshallah. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower his rahmah, his mercy upon each and every one of us, to shower his hidayah, his guidance upon us, to shower his forgiveness upon us, and to shower his acceptance upon us. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala again to shower his rahmah, his mercy upon me, by giving me the permission and the ability to be able to deliver this khutbah, inshallah. I ask Allah's help, I ask Allah's forgiveness, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower unto me the quality of tawakkal ala Allah, the trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower unto me the quality of taqwa, piety, the iman, the faith, the hikmah, the wisdom, the ilm, the knowledge, and the ability to be able to fulfill this responsibility in delivering the khutbah, inshallah. I put my trust, I put my tawakkal in Allah, and indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most sufficient. For those of us who were here last week, brothers and sisters, as usual, I like to recap on the past khutbah so we will have an idea as to where we're continuing from. And you would remember we touched on the verse or the ayah in Surah Muhammad, chapter 47, verse 38, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about His invitation, to us, inviting the believers to spend out of what Allah has given to them. And then Allah says, and He refers to those who refuse to spend as the bakhil, the misers. And Allah continues in that verse, verse 38 of chapter 47, Surah Muhammad, by saying that they who are misers in spending in the path of Allah, Allah reminds them that He, Allah, is Ghani and He does not need anything from us. And they who are misers in spending in the path of Allah, they are the fuqara, they are the beggars. Very powerful verse. That's why we have the CDs and the DVDs so you can take home and we could look at it. And the topic of last week khutbah is misers are wealthy beggars. Because a miser is someone who has. And when they don't spend, then they look like beggars. Because if we can't enjoy what Allah has given to us, and you know, very interesting, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, a miser is a man who loses on all sides. In this world, he loses because he does not enjoy his wealth. And in the akhirah, he's punished for not using his wealth. So he neither gets the dunya nor the akhirah. Both ways he loses. Suffers here and suffers there. And if we would look back at the life of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even though he was not a man who lived in big homes and big houses and did all the extravagance, he was never considered a poor man or a miser. He was considered a humble man. But let me correct the word from poor. He lived the life of a poor man, but not the life of a beggar. That's why in Islam, he lived the life of a humble poor man, but not the life of a beggar. Hence, it became haram for him to accept zakat. He never, ever kept even a date, or as we would say today, a dollar or a cent that was supposed to be given in zakat, used it for himself. Because it was haram for him to use that. So he never lived the life of a beggar. Let's get that very clear. Because he had, but he lived humble. So Allah in this verse here, and we'll continue in the second khutbah on this topic because we promised bi-idhnillah that we'll continue on it inshallah. So those of us who are not here, in continuation of this, misers are wealthy beggars. That's a topic of last week which we'll continue today inshallah in the second khutbah. Allah continues in this verse, in this chapter, Surah Muhammad. Allah continues to tell us in verse number 38, that those of us whom Allah has blessed with means, wealth, education, skills, ability, whatever Allah has blessed us with, if we don't use it, Allah says He will change us and get other people and put other people and give other people the responsibility, the means, the ability, the wealth, the education, who will be able to use it in the path of Allah. And Allah says, and I assure you that they will not do like us who didn't make use of the opportunities that Allah gave us. Hence, there's a very powerful hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which says that a time will come, and I would want to link this verse with that hadith, bi-idhnillah, inshallah, in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, a time will come when people will have wealth, or whether skills, or knowledge, or ability, whatever will be their wealth, and there will be no one to give it to. No way and no how to use it, because other people will already be occupied in it. Other people will already be wealthy and will not need it. Oh, Allah, bottom line, this verse says, will not need our contributions. So we will be very unfortunate. So in the second khutbah, inshallah, brothers and sisters, we want to continue on this line of dawah and spending our time and our effort in the path of Allah, because this is a very, very serious issue. It's a very important, it's farz, it's compulsory, and it's important that I remind myself and I remind you about it. A lot of us take this thing for granted. We take it as just dawah is for people who, in the masjids and the sheikhs and the imams, etc. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has taught us that even if we know one verse, one ayah of the Qur'an, we should take that message to other people. You don't have to be a hafiz of the Qur'an to do that. So we want to continue again on that verse and on the verse from Surah Ahzab, chapter 33, verse 46, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that He chose the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with Allah's permission. Allah appointed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be a da'i. So when we talk about da'i, da'wah, he is the man of da'wah that Allah sent to the world. And if we say that we're fortunate to be the followers of the da'i, then we are all supposed to be a da'i in the path of Allah. That's just the bottom line. And that's how it has to be. Other than that, we are not true followers of the da'i, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In the second khutbah, inshallah, again, bi-idhnallah, we'll continue on this topic, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us jannah without reckoning, inshallah. Wa akhir da'wan, alhamdulillahi rabbil
alamin. Wo sana kahan se laun teri shaan ke ho laiq wo sana kahan se laun tujhe aaye pyar jis par wo nida kahan se laun wo nida kahan se laun.
الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. Once more, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for blessing us to be here today to perform the Salat al-Jum'ah, to listen to the khutbah, and we pray and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower His peace and blessings onto the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa ala alihi wa sahabihi ajma'in. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us, to shower His mercy upon us, to shower His guidance upon us, and to shower His acceptance upon us. I again ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant me the permission from His rahmah, His mercy, the ability to continue with the second khutbah, inshallah. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower unto me the quality of tawakkul ala Allah, the trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the taqwa, the piety, the iman, the faith, the hikmah, the wisdom, the ilm, the knowledge, and the permission and ability to fulfill this responsibility in the second khutbah, inshallah. I put my tawakkul, I put my trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most sufficient. Just to read, to reiterate the verse that we started speaking about last week, inshallah. Surah Ahzab, chapter 33, verse 46, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, well, verse 45 and 46. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Ya ayyuhan nabi. Ya ayyuhan nabi, inna arsalnaka shahidan wa mubashiran wa nadhira. Allah says, O Prophet, Ya ayyuhan nabi, truly we have indeed sent you as a witness and one to give glad tidings and to give warnings. And then Allah continues in the next verse, وَدَاعِيًا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَدَاعِيًا إِلَى اللَّهِ بِإِذْنِهِ. And as a da'i, as a da'i, إِلَى اللَّهِ, Allahu Akbar, very powerful word, the name of Allah. As someone who invites people to Allah, وَدَاعِيًا إِلَى اللَّهِ بِإِذْنِهِ. Allah is saying, and I sent you, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as one to invite people to Allah with the permission of Allah. So we must make dua to Allah that Allah will choose us and grant us. That's why you see every time I begin my khutbah. See, sometimes a lot of you probably wonder, what is this man repeating this thing over and over? Has he run out of words? No, alhamdulillah. Bi-idhnillah, look the word here in this verse. Go take the CD after, listen to the, go and check the ayah. Chapter 33, Surah Ahzab, verse number 46. Bi-idhnillah. You hear me using bi-idhnillah every Friday in the khutbah. That bi-idhnillah this, bi-idhnillah we'll talk in the second khutbah. Bi-idhnillah we'll do this, and bi-idhnillah we said this. Because I try to remind myself by the mercy of Allah, and I ask Allah to continue to bless me so I will remember that. That I do nothing of my own because I know nothing. And everything that we do is bi-idhnillah, with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we must pray to Allah to choose us to spend our money, to spend our self, our time, our knowledge, our ability. And you know, if we have knowledge and money and ability and we don't use it, then we have not been given the permission by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, don't make that excuse to not spend it. Eh? A lot of people say, I'm going to keep my money because Allah didn't give me permission to spend it yet. That is the miser he's talking about. He already gave permission. Just go ahead and open your hearts and your pocket. Now is Allah to accept it from us. Allah will accept it from us when we spend the time and the ability and the effort in the part of Allah. This is the permission already here. Go ahead. He's saying, I have invited you. In Surah Muhammad, chapter 47, verse 38, and we'll read that verse after, inshallah. So Allah is telling us that we must invite to Allah. وَسِرَاجَمْ سِرَاجَمْ مُنِيرًا. And that should be like a lamp shining the light of Allah throughout the world. And let's go to the next verse so we don't lose touch with them. We put them together بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ, inshallah. Just to continue from last week. Surah Muhammad, ayah number 38. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Ha antum ha'ula. Ha antum haula'i tud'auna litunfiqu litunfiqu fi sabilillah. Subhanallah. Direct to the point. And that's why I want to repeat this verse and read it from the Qur'an. Because it's a little hardcore. Some of us, I know, could feel offended. But you know, whether we feel offended or not, I said last week, it doesn't matter to me. As long as I don't offend Allah. And we invite to Allah. Allah says, ye are those. Here is the permission. He's telling us, ye are those. You are the people that I have invited. لِتُنْفِقُوا فِي سَبِيلَ اللَّهِ, to spend in the path of Allah. So if we want to invite people to Allah, we got to spend time, we got to spend money, we got to spend education, we got to use technology, we got to spend everything that Allah has given to us. لِتُنْفِقُوا فِي سَبِيلَ اللَّهِ. Allah is saying, I invite you. He is inviting us. Come on, I'm inviting you all, he's saying. Spend what I've given to you to invite people to Allah. And that's how he continues to say, فَمِنْكُمْ مَنْ يَبْخَلْ. He says, but I know some of you are a bunch of cheapos, stingy, bakhil, kanjus, misers. Allah is saying it, not me. Bakhil, go check the Arabic word, bakhil. وَمَنْ يَبْخَلْ فَإِنَّمَا يَبْخَلُ عَنْ نَفْسِهِ. He says, and those who refuse to spend their money and their time and their knowledge and their skills and education in the path of Allah, let it be known that they are the ones who will be the losers and will cause harm to their own nafs. Their own souls will suffer in this world and in the hereafter. Allah doesn't lose anything. Because he's going down to tell us in the other part of the verse that he will take other people and give them the opportunity. He will get people with knowledge and wealth and skills and ability to do it if we don't want to do it. If we just come to Jummah to sleep and to sit down and listen to khutbah and just go for Jummah because we don't want to go into hell, well, that's a different thing. He said, you want to just be sleepers? Just go to masjid? You're concerned about yourself? We concern about ourselves not going to hell, so we pray, we read Quran, because we don't want to go to hell. But what about inviting people to Allah? You see, that's a whole different perspective. You know? That's the problem we have with a lot of our cultural Muslims. Alhamdulillah, the converts don't have the problem. And I've noticed that people who revert to Islam, they always want to encourage others and invite people to Allah. But a lot of our people, Guyanese and Trinis and Bangladeshis and Pakis and Arabs and the whole bunch of Indian cult and all the East and Middle East people, majority of us are a bunch of going to masjid, pray, sleep, and we don't care to invite other people to Allah. Some of us do, mashallah, I'm not saying no. But the majority of us don't. There are always a few, we know that. There are always a few who are willing to spend for the masjid, for dawah, for Islam, but the majority don't. And Allah is telling us it's not about coming to masjid. This is a verse not inviting Muslims to masjid. This is not a verse inviting Muslims to pray salah. These are verses inviting Muslims to spend their money and time to invite other people to Allah. If we don't remember, take the CD after. Wallahu al-ghaniyu wa antumul fuqara. Allah says he's Ghani. He doesn't want anything from us. He's the richest of the rich, the king of the kings. But the fuqara, the beggars are we. That he gave us knowledge, he gave us money, he gave us strength, he gave us youth, he gave us health, and we don't use it to invite people to Allah. Well, we are the bunch of beggars who have nothing. And you know it happens like that. Do you know that? Oh yeah, sometimes you have a lot of wealthy people, educated people, they're so bright, so much education, but they look like a bunch of nincompoops and dunce. Because Allah does not want the world to know that they're gifted with knowledge because they don't use the knowledge. There are a lot of people who are wealthy, but they look like beggars, like they have nothing. You know, that always happens. They look, because even Allah, because they don't use it, Allah is like, Not even the eyes of people do they look like if they have. But if we use our wealth and our money and our skills and our knowledge, people think. I'm not saying I spend, but I tell you something. I always wonder why people come to me to ask me for money and I don't have. Imagine if I had money, I'd have been considered Donald Trump. Because everybody asks me for money. People ask me, I told you last week, people invite me to come and raise money for them. Wealthy people invite me to raise money for them. And I don't have anything. I tell you, I live in the poorest home, in the poorest village, and the poorest town, and I chose that by the mercy of Allah. But yet wealthy people call me to raise money for them. And wealthy people come to me and say, hey, somebody wants help, could you help them? Oh, we need money to do this, could you get it for us? I don't know why they think I'm rich, but if Allah puts in the hearts of people I'm rich, it's just a rich heart. And if you spend in the part of Allah, Allah will let the world know you are rich, and Allah will announce to the angels that Allah has blessed this person and Allah is taking from this person. And when Allah loves you, He continues to take from you. Don't you notice that people who give donation, they always give, and people always go to them to give? Because Allah put in the hearts of other people that these are my servants and bandas, and my slaves and first servants who give, so go to them. Don't go to those conjuice misers people. And I always remember from a great sheikh, somebody had told him, he said, I know a couple of wealthy people that you should go to ask for money to build your, to do dawah and build your school and masjid. He said, I'm not really concerned about the wealthy people. I'm concerned about people who have iman and have wealth. If they have wealth and they don't have iman, I'm wasting my time. But if they have wealth and they have iman, then they will understand how to spend in the path of Allah. So the iman goes with it. Yeah. And hear what Allah says, they are the beggars. وَإِن تَتَوَلَّوْا يَسْتَبْدِلْ قَوْمًا غَيْرَكُمْ كُمْ. Allah says, and if we don't and turn our back from the opportunity to give in the path of Allah, and I'm not talking wealth alone, I'm saying education, because our knowledge, our wealth, our skills, everything is wealth. And if we don't do it as we should, and it's not how much we give, always remember that. It's not how much time we spend, it's not how much money we give, it's not how much we have done, it's how much Allah has given to us and how much we give out of what Allah has given to us. See, a lot of guys, once I was asking somebody to do something in the part of Allah, I said, I wanted to help spend some money to donate Quran. He said, I did that already when my father died. But it's not about your father died and you're doing it or you did it. It's how much Allah has given to us, that's how much we got to do. Or that Allah could tell us, I have already given to you. Just as we say, I did 100 books last year, or I distributed 500 Quran, or I spent on a masjid, or I did this dawah. Allah could say, well, I already gave you that money, I'm not going to give you again, no need for it. Just as we say, I have done it and I don't need to spend again. But the more we give is the more Allah gives us. It's like a well. The more you take water from a well, spring, the more it will spring up. Allah says that He will change us, qawman ghayrakum, to another group of people other than us, to do what He has chosen us to do, or what He has invited us to do if we refuse to do it. Thumma la yakunu amthalakum. He says, and He assures that those people will not do like us, inshallah. This is a serious verse. And I want to touch on another verse again, because you know what? I may forget to come back to this ayah. It's already 20 past. Very interested in Surah Hujurat. Hear this ayah. Surah Hujurat, chapter 49 of the Quran, ayah number 15. A punchline ayah. Allah says, and this is not my opinion, it's direct from the Quran. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إنما المؤمنون سبحان الله. He says, who are the believers? Certainly the believers. إنما المؤمنون إنما المؤمنون الذين آمنوا بالله. Certainly, 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 the believers are those who believe in Allah, number one. Amanu billahi wa rasuli. and those who believe in the Messenger of Allah, mashallah. And hear what he says. Thumma lam yartabu. Subhanallah. Wajahadu bi amwalihim wa anfusihim fi sabilillah. He says the true believers are those who believe in Allah, who believe in the Rasul of Allah, and who have no doubts in what Allah and his Rasul says. Hear what he says. ثُمَّ لَمْ يَرْتَابُ. And don't doubt Allah. When Allah says, give, do this, do that, don't do this, don't doubt Allah. The true believers are those who don't doubt Allah. وَجَاهَدُوا بِأَمْوَالِهِمْ وَأَنفُسِهِمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. We're talking about فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ here, بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. And those who spend out of themselves and their wealth, فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. They are the true believers. Here what he continues to reinforce what he says. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. Certainly the true believers are these people who believe in Allah, believe in his Rasul, don't doubt what Allah and his Rasul say, and they spend their wealth, their time, and strive in the path of Allah. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الصَّادِقُونَ. The good thing is we have Hufaz here and people who memorize the Qur'an. You have the CD to go verify the verse. Please don't go home and say, I said this. I'm just a nothing. I'm just reflecting back what this verse says. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الصَّادِقِينَ. Those who spend out of what we have given to them from themselves and their wealth. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الصَّادِقُونَ. Allah says, they are really the truthful believers. Not those who just come and pray Jumu'ah, sleep and go home. Let's get very much to the point. And that's what the khutbah is about, to remind ourselves. And that's what I'm here to remind myself. That's why I chose to do da'wah 24/7, inshallah. Because the truthful people are the ones who follow the da'i Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And those of us who came late, you got to clip this verse with the previous verse, Surah Azab, chapter 33, verse 46. Now, brothers and sisters, you know how important da'wah is? And this is something I think I want you to wake up and listen to this. This is a disaster that some of us really have not been contemplating on. You know, because we Muslims, the majority of us sit. Yes, Allah bless us. I must say before I get into this hardcore statement, which I know some of us are going to definitely feel offended with. And whether you feel offended or not, it doesn't really matter to me. It's what Allah, is what matters to Allah. I must say they are brothers, and I see brothers here and sisters who are very generous. They spend time, they spend money, they're willing to go in the path of Allah, they don't make excuses. I know that we have those brothers here and sisters. I mean, I must say, last week, the dinner we had, 500 people, Al-Hikmat Dawah program. You know, we had over 60 tables that brothers and family sponsored. Very immaculate, alhamdulillah. Allah bless all those brothers. You know, we asked to raise some books. And 5 minutes, brothers, just help sponsor the Salah book that we have. And we wanted to give to masjids and non-Muslims and people who want to learn to pray. 5 minutes, your generous brothers, raise your hands, sisters, immediately. So we have Allah, people that Allah has chosen and blessed. And there were even brothers who came on. I said, please, we got other books to do. We got an Arabic book we're trying to do, the Quran. I said, brothers, out of your own heart, just give. And there are people who gave. Alhamdulillah, Allah has chosen people. So when I say these things, I don't mean everybody. But I mean those of us who are not doing it, we need to wake up and smell the coffee. You know, I was telling you last week, it was supposed to be last week. You see this brochure? Alhamdulillah. One brother, Brother Siddiq, and family and friends have taken the responsibility. And Alhamdulillah, Sun Sentinel has accepted to do this tomorrow. Sun Sentinel newspaper and Sunday newspaper is going to run this entire Dawah brochure. So you guys who are ashamed to spread the message of Islam, look what the Quran says. Allah is using Sun Sentinel to do it. There are Muslims, don't even take one of this and give it to another non-Muslim. There are Muslims, I said, contribute towards it, $75, you do 150. You know, you can do $1,000 of this, $500, $100, $200. He had a sun sentinel. Do you know they had to approve it before they do it? Oh, it had to go to the editors and the board, especially today with Islam. They had to go through the 9 yards of screening this entire brochure, One God, One Religion, that we put together in Al-Hikmat Dawah Center. And thousands of people will be getting this over this weekend, inshallah. The non-Muslims have decided to join hands with us to spread the dawah. And I know I have Muslims, I ask them to contribute towards this. Some of them wouldn't take it and distribute it. But Allah, look at the verse, is going to use non-Muslims to spread the message. Because we need it. And it's never too late. We still have it there. Take it for free, those of you who want to spread the message. And those of you who want to contribute it, go see the Al-Hikmat Dawah table. Go, do it, Sadqa Jarrah, send it out. Because I'm telling you, when it comes out this weekend in the newspaper, a lot of non-Muslims will be asking for the original copy. Lot more, because of the thousands who will be getting it in Sun Sentinel this weekend, Saturday and Sunday, inshallah. So I will need more to give out by the thousands. So if you want to get some blessings, join it. I ask you to build a house for me, and I ask you to buy a car for me. Asking you to join in inviting people to Allah, because that's the verse. And you know why it's important that we invite people to Allah? And I need to share this with some of us. Because Allah says in Surah Al Imran, chapter 3, verse 110, Kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat lin nas ta'muruna bil ma'ruf wa tanhauna 'anil munkar. That He has chosen us to enjoin good and to forbid evil. And we need to enjoin good and forbid evil. And you know, have you guys been looking at the news? I know some of you guys come and sleep here, you don't even listen to the news, you don't listen to the khutbah, you don't see the news. If you look around, you see a bunch of guys sleeping against the wall. These are what we call a bunch of sleepers. I just say it as I see it. Not as I hear it. I say it as I see it. I don't believe what I hear. Did you hear what President Obama said? Come, you bunch of Muslims who sit and listen to khutbahs. Do you know what a sad situation we are in this country? Huh? Allah bless him and Allah give him hidayah and guidance. And my job is to give the message. Here you have the President of the United States of America saying that a man could marry a man. Come on, man. We slept? Are we sleeping? Do you believe in the Qur'an? Are we going to sit and have the Qur'an being ridiculed? Do you know in the Bible and in the Torah, Leviticus chapter 18 verse 22 and chapter 20 verse 13, the Bible says, and if a man sleeps with a man, he should be killed. I ain't saying that. Go check the Bible, and all who non-Muslims listen to this on television. I didn't say that. The scripture of God, the Torah, the Bible, the Torah says that a man should not sleep with a man. Well, the rabbis came up, and I'm speaking from an interfaith point of view. I'm not criticizing nobody. This is research, and I will say this in the synagogue. I say it wherever. Because the Torah says that a man should not sleep with a man, marry a man, some of the modern day Jews have said, well, if it says man shouldn't sleep with man, well, then woman could sleep with woman. So they permit lesbians. Oh, yeah, that's the law. I'm just telling you the law. But the Bible, the Torah, the Quran unanimously disagree and condemn and has even gone so far. While the Quran only says that they have broken the law of Allah in chapter 7, verse 81. Remember it or take the CD after. Because you know what is sad about our bunch of Muslims? We come, we sleep, we listen. We don't believe in the Quran. But the president says this. He says, hey boy, whoa, man could sleep with man. So I'm going to start doing that too. My president has authorized it. What's going on? I'm not going against the president here right now. I'm saying what he says is not biblical, is not according to the Quran. And I can't follow that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told me, and the Prophet has told us, Allah has told us that if you see something wrong, you hear something wrong, you stop it with your hands, but we can't beat him for that. But we got to speak out against it. And all of us Muslims who sleep and just come to Jummah and go back and sleep and eat and don't speak out against it, Allah says that silence, the Prophet says that silence is the lowest level of iman. I'm sure a lot of us looked at that and say, oh, true boy, what? You know, it wouldn't hurt us now, you know. It will hurt you when a man comes home by your house and say, hey, I want to offer, I have a proposal to marry your son. Then we'll say, oh my gosh, it's legal? You didn't realize that legal, but what am I going to do? Am I racist now? See, when somebody knocks over, and don't think it's a joke, eh? What's the name of the other guy on the news this week? John Travolta? What's his name? John Travolta, right? You see what's happened with him? Prominent superstar. He's been accused this week. All these things happened this week. You know, sometimes I wonder what to talk about, but I get topics from the Quran, alhamdulillah. Imagine, here is a harassment. Whether he tried to hold down someone or someone he tried to hold him down or whatever is happening here. But a man is accused by another man for harassment. For sexual harassment. And a big man like that, not any 2x2 on the side. Go read what has happened this week. So when these things start, which are the signs of Qiyamah, and we Muslims sleep over this, it's a sad situation. This is total haram. Go check the Quran, chapter 7, verse 81. Allah says that it is, Allah detests that man who sleeps with another man. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam detests a man to even dress like another man, a woman to look like a man, or to imitate a man in dressing. Fallas, the man want to marry a man? This is total Quran, Torah, scriptures of Allah. The words of God being ridiculed here. Now, who want to do it? That's between them and their God. But our job is to teach the people and remind them to stay away from bad. And I'm not just, nobody can't accuse me and say I'm just telling them a Quranic thing. I'm telling them the Torah and the Bible says this. Very serious, isn't it? Kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat linnas ta'muruna bil ma'ruf wa tanhauna 'anil munkar. Allah says he has chosen us to enjoin good and forbid evil. And if we sit down and shake our head and say, oh, very good, Obama, good, good, good. Nice thing, man, we like it. Or if we even say we don't like it, that's the weakest stage of iman. So check how many people just sit and accept this. You know the sign of Qiyamah? Here's a statement that a man could marry a man. And you know the Torah, the Quran, the Bible. I'm just showing you how Satan plays with our minds. Not that I want to say this, but I want to compare the signs of Qiyamah. That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said that the signs of Qiyamah, when people will accept wrong and haram and adultery and fornication and alcohol and crime and all the haram things would look halal and legal, and the halal things would look haram. The halal things will be like burning coals in our hands, like iman. We wouldn't want to accept what the Quran says, but what is haram, we'll easily accept it. Think about it. You know, if a Muslim gets up on television and say that a man could have 4 wives, all our Muslim ladies gonna get crazy. Some of our women, men will get mad, those who don't believe in the Quran. Everybody will go mad. But here the president says a man could marry a man, but you can't say a man could have 4 wives. That the Quran says, the Bible says, and the Torah. Nowhere in the Torah, nowhere in the Bible, nowhere in the Psalms prohibits that a man could have more than one wife. Go check it. Because Jacob, Yaqub, alayhi salam, had 4 wives. Suleiman and David had many wives. Nowhere in the Torah and the Bible forbids it. Nowhere in the Quran forbids it. In fact, they encourage it. But you know, if I say a man could have more than one wife, all are a bunch of half-baked Muslims here, because so you hear what he preaching. But Obama say a man could marry a man, and we say, yes, President, I'm going to vote for you. That's the Muslims' iman that we have today. I'm just telling you as it is. I'm not telling you who to vote for and who not to vote for, but as a Muslim, I really don't want Allah to ask me on the day of judgment that you know this is haram in the Quran and you shut your mouth. I don't want to go to hell for that. If you want to go to hell for that, that's up to you. On the other hand, I must congratulate Mr. Mitt Romney. I ain't campaigning for him, but he made it very clear that a man must marry a woman. I was wondering, one brother made a joke last week sometime. He said, what if Mitt Romney becomes president? Obama has authorized man to marry man, and he becomes president, and he authorized man could have more than one wife. Well, he legal, remember, he's from the Mormon religion, and Mormons could have more than one wife. So another person got up and said, well, Mitt Romney doesn't have to authorize more than one wife. The Quran already authorized it. We don't need Mitt Romney to authorize it. And we don't need Mitt Romney to say a man could marry a woman. The Quran has given us the guide. But you know, we don't even, some of us don't understand it. And some of us who understand it, we don't give the dawah. Listen, it's important, you know. I'm telling you, when states start legalizing man could marry man, you'll be amazed to know your son will come home and say, this is my husband. Then you guys will come and say, oh boy, Sheikh really told us that in a member a few years ago. This is what I have to face. Or your daughter might come home and say, I don't want to get married. When she reaches a certain age and you want to know why she doesn't get married, it's because you're realizing she already have another woman in her life. Then you would realize, where did my Quran go? Maybe I wasn't spending the part of Allah. I was not spreading the message of Allah. So the disaster and calamity fall on my own home and our own families. And listen, don't deny it. Eh? They already got Muslim gay communities. You guys know that? Yes. They already got gay Muslim communities. I'm not here to say where and when and how, because this is broadcasted all over. They got it in London and they got it in America. You go do the research. People who go and propagate that to be contrary to the Quran, the Bible, and the Torah is their way of life. And we come here, some of us sleeping. We don't want to spend message to give the dawah. We don't want to spend time to give the dawah. That's why Allah says, invite to the way of Allah. Brothers and sisters, time really doesn't permit. But please, I know this is a very, listen, I used to have a lot of positions in the board in Broward County. And because I spoke out on homosexuality, I got sacked from many boards. Because there were a lot of gay people who said, we don't want him on that board. But I had a choice to sit on the board or sit in paradise or go to hell. Sit in the board and go to hell or say what Allah says I should say. And I admire those priests and those rabbis and those religious leaders who speak out whatever Obama likes or whatever Mitt Romney likes. That's their life. But if somebody says something against the scripture, I think it's my duty as a brother to you and we and myself that we need to remind ourselves, go check the Quran, chapter 7, verse 81. Go check the Bible, the Torah, Leviticus 18, 22, and 20:13. How even the Bible is even more harsh on a man sleeping with a man. This is serious. And this is ta'muruna bil ma'ruf wa tanhauna 'anil munkar. And this, that verse that we spoke about in Surah Ahzab, and time doesn't permit me to get into it, is all about the da'i ilallah. Allah says that He chose the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet says that He chose us to carry out the da'wah and the message that He was chosen for, and He was sent to the world to spread the message of the Quran and teach the people the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And if we don't, I'm only giving a message. Please, that's why I have a DVD and a CD that if anybody tries to hold on to me for this, that I say, I have not condemned the president. I have not condemned Mitt Romney. I just said this is what he said, what Fox News say, and what CNN News say. And if he didn't say this, well, then hold CNN and Fox News against it. I'm just reporting what the news reporter said. And I'm referring to that statement with the Quran, with the Torah, and the Bible. Okay? But we got to be very careful. Please spread the message of Allah, the message of God. Make sure your children, your family, the people around, spread the message. If people get God in their lives, they will worship God and forget about all these haram things. That's just the bottom line. But we need to spread the message of God. And as I told you again, this weekend, Saturday and Sunday, this is going to be on Sun Sentinel. Alhamdulillah, the Sun Sentinel has joined hands with us to spread the message of Islam. It's going to be thousands and thousands of homes in South Florida. I think I told you already that Al-Hikmat TV now is live on iPhone and iPad. Now, that doesn't mean you guys could stay in your work and look at the khutbah. Yeah? It's on your iPad. You see, you got to have a smartphone. Al-Hikmat is about a smart technology, so we're on smartphone. So you could see the khutbah live, and 24/7 we're live on phone. You know why? We're trying to get this dawah. That's the whole reason why. This dawah, this message, technology, wherever we could, the newspaper, on the TV, on internet, computers, iPads, we take these khutbahs all over. So when I tell you about spending the part of Allah, I'm not just talking from the member. I told you there are a bunch of generous people here because they helped us with the dinner, they sponsor with us. Allah bless them. But I must tell you, it's always just that 10%. The 90%, they just sit and they look at the world spin. They don't help us with the dawah, they don't help us with the books, they don't even offer something. They want you to give them free tables and free food and put them to eat, and they don't even donate towards the dawah. Here is some sentinel donating towards it. And that's why we took the khutbah on iPhone now, because there are a lot of people who told us, non-Muslims and Muslims, that in their jobs, they don't get time off to come. They don't have access to the computers, but they could look at it on phone. So Al-Hikmat has gone live khutbah on telephone, inshallah. But don't let that be an excuse to not come Jummah, because I'm going to carry sin. But I want to pray to Allah to bless us. Wake us up, go check back those verses we have spoken about. Surah Hujurat, chapter 49, Surah Ahzab, Surah Muhammad, about the da'i, about spending in the path of Allah, spending our time, using technology, using our ability. And Allah says that those who spend from their wealth and themselves, they are the true believers and they are the sincere ones. Ya Allah, Ya Rahman, Rahmin, Ya Ghafur, Rahim. Alhamdulillah, Ya Allah, we thank thee for all the favors and bounties you have bestowed upon us, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, Ya Allah. We ask thee, Allah, to shower your peace and mercy unto the Holy Prophet, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Forgive us for our shortcomings, Ya Allah. Choose us with your permission, with your love, and with your acceptance to be da'i in your path, Ya Allah. Choose us to be those who will spread the message and invite people to you, and invite people to your message of the Qur'an, Ya Allah. And help us to enjoin good and forbid evil as you send the prophets and the messengers to the world to do, Ya Allah. Take from us and our education, our money and our self and our ability for the part of, for your path, fi sabilillah, so we could be blessed and we could be chosen and we could be forgiven and be granted Jannah without reckoning, inshaAllah. Rabbana atina fi dunya hasanata wa fil akhirati hasanata wa qina adhaban nar bi rahmatika ya إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا مولانا محمد وعلى آل محمد بعدد من صلى وسلم اللهم صل على سيدنا مولانا محمد وعلى آل محمد بعدد من قعد وقام وصل على جميع الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى كل ملائكتك المقربين وعلى عباد الله الصالحين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين عباد الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون ولذكر الله تعالى أعلى وأولى وأعز وأجل وهم وأكبر الله أكبر أقم الصلاة
مدینے کے دن رات اللہ اکبر مدینے کی کیا بات اللہ اکبر مدینے کے دن رات اللہ اکبر مدینے کی کیا بات اللہ اکبر مدینے کے دن رات اللہ اکبر مدینے کی کیا بات اللہ اکبر مدینے کے دن رات اللہ اکبر مدینے کی کیا بات اللہ اکبر اللہ اکبر اللہ اکبر اللہ اکبر اللہ اکبر اللہ اکبر اذانوں کے لمحات اللہ اکبر نمازوں کے اوقات اللہ اکبر اذانوں کے لمحات اللہ اکبر نمازوں کے اوقات اللہ اکبر اللہ اکبر اللہ اکبر اللہ اکبر اللہ اکبر Allahu Akbar. Ye qabr un nabi aur ye mehrab o mimbar. Ye qabr un nabi aur ye mehrab o mimbar. Muqaddas maqamat. Allahu Akbar. Muqaddas maqamat.